Thanks for joining us for Celebration of Worship. First United Methodist Church is a welcoming community of faith that strives to be a place where everyone can belong, believe, and become a blessing. At First United Methodist Church, you can come just as you are to grow in your desire to know Christ, as well as discover your own unique way of making the world a better place at 201 Monroe Street in Jefferson City. We hope you enjoy today's message.
I also want to lift up our trunk or treat candy drive. So we are collecting all kinds of candy. If you got candy, we want it. So you can bring it out here. We are collecting both for Thorpe Gordon and for our trunk or treat that will be taking place here later this month. We're going to close down the street down here. So if you see a nice sale on a bag of candy, grab it, bring it to church. I know that there are plenty of kiddos who will be looking forward to getting all sugared up, courtesy of First United Methodist Church later this month. We've also got our Give Us Your Goods drive that our youth and young adults are taking part in. So we need some folks who are willing to hand out some flyers in their communities to let folks know that we're going to be collecting some goods. Our youth will collect those on Sunday the 23rd and bring those into church, and they are going for a military food pantry. And so I think that would be a great way to also support. If you're not, don't find a good deal on candy, you can always find a good 2-for-1 deal on some beans or something like that that you can help to support.
Good morning. My name is Daniel Hilty, and I'm one of the pastors here, along with Pastor Chelsea and Karen and Steve. And it is really good to have you here this morning. Welcome to our 8:30 worship service. I want to say a special word of welcome, as Chelsea did, to those of you who are guests, those of you who are watching, live streaming. We're grateful to God for each of you. You have decided to be a guest or to watch or live stream on a great day. That was really, your anthem made me cry. Thank you so much. That was a beautiful anthem. Arise my soul, right? God claims us, claims you, me, as children of the Lord. Shake off the guilt we can no longer fear. That was powerful stuff. That was awesome. I also want to say just how wonderful it is that Brenda Stoneburner is coordinating our new acolyte ministry. And isn't it wonderful to have acolytes leading us in the service now, too? We're so grateful to God for them. Such a blessing. Later on in the morning, at our other services, Brenda's also leading some of our children in puppet ministry, leading worship, and so just a morning of great blessings all around. And last night we celebrated a baptism, the baptism of Harper Grace Moss, and so we give thanks to God for that special celebration and the newest member of our family of faith in Harper. Well, I have the privilege of getting to share in the sermon time with us this morning. I'm excited to get to do that because we're continuing this Love Better series, and we are talking about this really kind of obscure scripture reading that we don't talk about very much in church. But I have found it for several years now to be one of the most interesting and fascinating passages in the writings of the Apostle Paul in scripture. And so I'm excited to get to talk to share with us today about that. But before we get to any of that, would you please join with me in a moment of prayer? Let's pray. Oh God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for the gift of this morning. We thank you for a new day and sun shining outside and blue skies and the gift of your presence in the people around us in this room, folks that we know well, perhaps, or folks that we don't know very well, perhaps, but are well-known and well-loved to you. We pray, O Lord, that you would please be in all that we have to offer up to you this morning, our singing, our speaking, our thinking, our feeling. Use all of this, O Lord, to draw us closer to you, to the neighbors to whom you send us. We lift to you, O Lord, our hearts, our hopes and our fears, our joys. Receive us, O Lord, as an offering to you. We pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. So, as I mentioned just a moment ago, today is the second week in our new series, simply titled Love Better, right? And we're calling the series Love Better because here at First United Methodist Church, we believe that our mission is to love better, right? That God has put us here to try to help figure out how we can help each other, how we can help our neighbors, to love God better, to love each other better, to love our world better, to love Jesus better, to love ourselves better. And in order to help us do this, in order to help us figure out how to love better, if you remember from last week, if you were here, we believe that God has given us, through the Methodist tradition, through the Methodist inheritance, three simple rules, three short rules that we can follow to help us do this, to love better. And they are, do no harm, do good, and stay connected. All right? Stay connected to God, stay connected to each other. These are three rules that can help us love better as individuals and as a church. And we're going to be looking at each of these more in depth over the next few weeks. But this morning, we're going to start off just by focusing on the first one, do no harm. Do no harm. Now, I realize that of the three rules, do no harm is probably the least exciting, right? It probably sounds the least flashy, right? Do good makes us think about, you know, going out there and changing the world, right? Let's do good, right? And stay connected gives us a sense of belonging, right? Oh, we're so connected, right? We're connected to God, we're connected to each other. But do no harm, right? Do no harm doesn't exactly give us a warm, fuzzy feeling, right? Do no harm. It sounds like we're trying to accomplish a positive through the absence of a negative. Right? Saying that we can love better by doing no harm kind of sounds like sending your sweetheart a Valentine's Day card, right, that says, "My Valentine, I don't dislike you," right? But a piece of advice, if you get this card in the mail from your sweetheart, you got trouble, right? It's kind of... So saying that we can love better by doing no harm kind of feels like a Valentine's card that says, "I don't dislike you," right? It feels like trying to accomplish a positive through the absence of a negative. And yet, there is a lot of ancient wisdom, right? A lot of ancient wisdom, ancient teaching that instructs us that doing no harm really can be the first step, an important step in loving better, right? In loving better. One of my favorite stories comes from about 300 years ago, for example. 300 years ago, there was a Jewish rabbi who told the story of two friends who were sitting across from each other at a table, right? And maybe they were drinking coffee, maybe they were drinking tea, I don't know, but they were good friends, right? And they were old friends. And suddenly the first friend asked the other, "My good friend, my dearest friend, do you love me? Do you love me?" And the second friend was kind of taken back, right? That's not exactly the thing you expect to hear out of your lifelong friend when you're sharing coffee together, right? But he kind of stumbled around a little bit, and he said, "Well, you know, of course I do, right? Of course I love you. You're an old friend. You're a dear friend. I love you very much." And the first friend said, "I see. Thank you." He said, "Well, then let me ask you another question. Do you know what hurts me?" And now the second friend was really confused, right? Because it just suddenly this conversation had taken a really weird turn. And so he stumbled around some more for words and fumbled around some more for words. And eventually he said, "Well, you know, no, right? I don't know what hurts you. Why would I know what hurts you? I just told you you're my friend and I love you. And why would you even ask something like that?" And in response, the first friend said, "How can you say that you love me if you don't know what hurts me? How can you say that you love me if you don't know what hurts me?" And the rabbi concluded the story by saying that question, this question, really got more at the heart of what love is all about that day than anything else, right? Real love, the rabbi said, begins by getting to know another human being well enough, right? Deeply enough, caring about them deeply enough to understand their hurts, right? So that we know how to do no harm, right, in their lives. Go back about 1,700 years before the rabbi, and we find the same teaching in the Bible as well, specifically in the writings of the Apostle Paul, this passage I mentioned a few moments ago. The Apostle Paul was a master of understanding that real love means caring enough about another human being to get to know the things that hurt them in their lives, right? That cause suffering in their hearts. For example, this passage, 1 Corinthians chapter 10. This is a passage that contains these great verses where the Apostle Paul instructs Christians to love better by getting to know each other's hurts. Right? By getting to know each other's hurts. It begins like this. Paul says, "Do not seek your own advantage. Do not seek your own advantage, but that of the other." And then it gets really interesting. He says, "Eat whatever is sold in the meat market, without raising any questions on the ground of conscience, for the earth and its fullness are the Lord's. If an unbeliever invites you to a meal and you are disposed to go, eat whatever is set before you without raising any question on the ground of conscience." So we're going to pause here for a second. So what's going on here, right? What's going on here in this passage? Is this a biblical argument against vegetarianism, right? Is this a passage in the Bible that all of us meat eaters and carnivores can say, yes, there it says eat meat, right? Well, it's not really what it's getting at, right? That's not what it's really about. You see, back in Bible times, a lot of the meat sold was sold in markets associated with temples to other gods, right? Other gods from the perspective of Christians and Jewish people, right? Foreign gods from their perspective. And so a lot of the meat that was sold in these markets, right? Connected to the worship of these other gods. Either the meat was left over from sacrifices to these foreign gods, or the meat was sold with the intention that it would be sacrificed, right? As part of the worship of these other gods. And so there was a debate, right? There was a debate among early Christians about whether it was okay for them to eat this meat, right? To eat this meat that came from these markets. Like if they went to a friend's house, right, who worshiped some of these other gods, and they served this meat, would it be okay to eat it? And on the one hand, there were Christians who said, you know what? It's fine, right? It's fine. There's only one God, right? There are no other gods. It's totally fine for us to eat the meat. Just go ahead and eat the meat. But on the other hand, there were some Christians who were really bothered, right, by this idea of eating meat connected with the worship of other gods. They felt like they were being unfaithful, right? They felt like they were Royals fans drinking Coke from a Cardinals cup, right? There's this kind of, like they were the other team. And so this argument is going on, this debate's going on, and so Paul writes to them, right? Paul steps into this dilemma. And it's interesting, he kinda plays both sides, right, in the argument. Which incidentally also makes Paul the first Methodist, right? And so in this verse, Paul essentially says, you know what, if someone from another religion is kind enough to invite you to their home for a dinner, just be a good guest and eat what they give you, right? Just be a good guest and eat what they serve. Because otherwise you might hurt them. You might do harm, right? You might do harm. But, then Paul says in the next verse, but if someone says to you, this has been offered in sacrifice, then do not eat it, Paul says, out of consideration for the one who informed you and for the sake of conscience. I mean the other's conscience, not your own. So the someone, right, the someone that Paul is imagining here is another Christian, right? Paul says that if another Christian is truly hurt by the fact that you're eating this meat that had been sacrificed to other gods, then refrain from eating it. But do it not for your sake, but for their sake, he says. In other words, Paul says, show your love better by being sensitive to what hurts other people, right? Even if it doesn't hurt you. Even if you don't understand it, right? Even if it doesn't make sense to you. In his own way, Paul is encouraging the folks in the early church to ask themselves the same question that the rabbi asked in the story I told a few moments ago. How can you say that you love me if you don't know what hurts me? Paul is asking his fellow Christians how they can say they can love each other if they don't take each other's hurts seriously, their feelings seriously. For Paul, this was a crucial question, right? This was a crucial question for the early church to keep in mind if they really wanted to love better. And you know what? It's still a crucial question for the church today to keep in mind if we really want to love better. Because, you know, I am convinced, right? I am convinced that one of the world's greatest needs today, one of the world's greatest needs today is to have a place, right? For the world to have a place where people from different backgrounds and different places in life can actually get to know each other well enough to learn what hurts each other, right? Not so that we can exploit those hurts, but so that we can understand them, right? The world is desperate for a place like that, right? Because doing no harm begins with understanding what hurts each other and what doesn't. Because, you know, most of the time, it's so easy just to dismiss the hurts of other people, right? I do that far too often in my own life. When someone expresses hurt, right, or anger or frustration on TV, on the news, on the internet, on Facebook, or even face-to-face, right? It's so easy just to kind of wave that away, right? Just wave it away and say, oh, you know, they're just being irrational, right? Or, oh, they're just putting on a show. Or, oh, they're just being ignorant, right? Or evil, or mean, or closed-minded, or bleeding heart, or snobby, or crude, or lazy, or selfish, or old-fashioned, or a million other things, right, that we tell ourselves to make us believe that their hurts don't matter as much as our hurts. And I say those kind of things to myself far more often than I like to admit. And yet, when we say things like that, when people say things like that, when I say things like that, it comes at a cost, right? And the cost is that it slowly divides us up, right? It slowly tears us apart, right? As families or as a people or as a world, so that eventually we don't even know how to talk to each other, right? But what if there was a place that was different from that? What if there was kind of an oasis of something better in the midst of all of that, right? What if there was a place where people, you know, cared enough and listened enough actually to understand the hurts of people who came from other backgrounds than our own? That would be a place where folks could start to love better, right? And that, I believe, is God's calling for us, right? God's calling the First United Methodist Church is to be that different kind of place, a place where we may not all agree with each other. It'd be boring if we all agreed with each other, right? But a place where people seek to understand each other because they believe that that's the first step in learning to love better. And we believe that because that's what Jesus himself believed, right? It's how Jesus himself lived. See, back in Bible times, you know, different ages, different places in the world, we had different ways of saying the same thing, right? Back in Bible times, people didn't say things like, so tell me about your hurt, right? Let me understand your suffering, right? At least, not that we can tell from the Bible. People really didn't talk like that, like we might today. Instead, as I understand things, as I read things, if someone was hurting back in Bible times, and you wanted to show concern for them, you ask them, so what do you want? in the midst of your hurt, in the midst of your suffering, what is it that your heart wants? What do you want the most in the midst of all of this? Let me understand. What do you want? And I did a little Bible search. There's only one person in the whole Bible who asked that question, what do you want? And guess. It's Jesus, right? It's Jesus. In fact, he asked it 5 times over the course of the Bible. People who are hurting, who are suffering, who are sick. What do you want? He asks them. In other words, Jesus embodied the fact that loving better begins by coming to know another person well enough to understand what they want in the midst of their hurt, in the midst of their suffering. And that's why here at First United Methodist Church, one of our top priorities is to create opportunities and ministries where people can get to know each other and understand each other better, right? Understand other people better, especially people from different places in life. That's why from the very beginning, the emphasis at Common Ground has been on taking time to get to know each person who comes through the door. That's why in our partnership with Thorpe Gordon, the emphasis is on building relationships with the students, truly trying to understand what they're facing in life. It's why at Project Homeless Connect, which we can sign up for in the lobby, the most important ministry is simply to spend time with someone who is experiencing homelessness, just to hear their story. It's why guests who come to our Fresh Start Market are greeted with a hospitality center. It's why our neighborhood dinners are focused on spending time with our neighbors. It's why our student and youth ministry is focused on outreach. It's why we try to include stories and testimonies from people in different walks of life during our sermons, right? People who are police officers or veterans or students or members of other religions or people from different parts of the world. It's why we do joint worship services and pulpit exchanges with Quinchapogue African Methodist Episcopal Church and Washington Metropolitan African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church. We do all of that in part because God has called our church to be a different kind of place, right? Where people from different backgrounds can get to know each other, because the more we get to know each other, the more we understand what hurts each other. And the more we understand what hurts each other, the less harm we do. And the less harm we do, the better we love. Right? And the fact that God has given First United Methodist Church the chance to be a place like that is one of the reasons that I love this church so much. It's why I'm so proud to be a part of this church. And so over the next few weeks, as we receive our stewardship packets in the mail, members and people who've been attending for a while, you'll be receiving stewardship packets in the mail. If you're a guest today, you won't be receiving a stewardship packet unless you really want it, right? We can work it out, but I'm just joking. But as we receive those stewardship packets, and as we consider our financial pledge to the church for next year, for 2018, I invite us not just to think and pray about the programs, the specific programs we are supporting with our money, but also the understanding between people that you are helping to create here. Right? The understanding between people that you're helping to create here. Because honestly, creating understanding is one of the most important ways that we can continue the work of Jesus Christ in the world today. And it's not hard. It's something we could even give a try on our own this week. All it takes is a moment or two to listen to someone, maybe who comes from a different place in life, and to hear about their hurts and their hopes. And that doesn't mean we have to fix it. The main thing is just to understand it, right? Just to understand. Just understanding, right, is how we follow in the footsteps of a Savior who cared enough to ask people who were hurting, what do you want? What's going on in your life? Right? Just understanding, right? Just understanding really is the first step in learning to love better. Thanks be to God. Amen. The foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song.